lost my mother and I want a mother and I'm sad. Why have I not got a mother? Why is there no one with me? From somewhere behind my head, I heard a voice say, I will be your mother. But no one was there. She looked at me eye to eye, and she smiled and she said, I will be your mother for the third time. I went into this church and I found all the people making a matanya, that is bowing down to the icon of Saint Mary. And I was astonished, because Australian men don't bow down to anybody. I mean, the usual greeting in Australia is a handshake, and that's it. Even if a taxi driver meets the Prime Minister, he will not bow down to him, he will not kiss his hand, he will not even bend his head unless he wants to. He will just shake his hand, and that will be it. So informal and equal greetings between people of very different standing is just the Australian norm. So I had no preparation for the matanya, for the abasing of oneself physically, for bending down to make an obeisance to a figure of abstract power. So I didn't feel easy, but I wanted to be polite. And I saw all the Serbian people make their matanyas to this icon of Saint Mary. And after they finished their three matanyas, they went to the side of the church where the priest was praying. And the people start to sing hymns to St. Mary with the priest. I thought, okay, let me do what they do. So I tried to make the first matanya. And I stood from standing. Let me show you. From standing, I should be erect. I should be homo erectus. You know? I should be a strong man. Then I have to make myself weak. I have to put myself down on the ground. So I tried, bending my knees and bowing down. Okay? So, this was the first part of the effort, the first part of the struggle of the matanya, if I can call it that. Finally, I got down on my knees. Now remember that the icon of St. Mary is in front of me, on the wall, a big, big icon. It was very famous in Australian religious circles because it had made some miraculous cures. There was a wife of a Greek priest who had cancer, and she was healed by intercession through this icon. And it was well known in Australia. People who are not from that particular church, still they came to visit to see that icon. So I wasn't much concerned about the icon. I was more concerned about making my matanya smoothly and joining the people. Then I had to put my forehead on the floor. Okay, now this was a big difficulty for me. I never did this in my whole entire life. So I tried. I didn't put my fingers correctly, but it doesn't matter. I bowed my head down. So I finally got down to the ground. And when I was in that position, if I might ask you to consider, when you make a matanya, what is the position of your body? How does it shape itself? Maybe you don't see yourself from outside, but think about how the shape of your body appears to someone watching you. You are in a half circle, like you are bent over in much the same position as a fetus in the womb. Okay, you look at any picture of a fetus in the womb of its mother. Not exactly like a seahorse, but it's kind of folded around on itself, right? So I was feeling like that. I was feeling that I am in a kind of fetal position, and I'm becoming small, and I'm becoming weak and helpless. So all of these emotions started to overtake me as I made the matanya. The matanya is a physical action, but its effect is very devastating on the psychology, on the emotions, because it says, you are weak, you are small, you are nothing, you are dust and ashes. It's a statement that I am not worthy to lift up my eyes to you. The matanya is a very eloquent statement of Christian humility. So I was bending down, and all my sadness at my mother's death started to overflow started to come out from me. And I started to cry. I started to let the tears come, and I started to vocalize my sadness. As I was telling myself, I thought, actually I was praying, I was confessing. I didn't know at the time how God had planned it, but I was outpouring my feelings. I said, I don't have a mother, I lost my mother, and I want a mother, and I'm sad, and I need a... Why have I not got a mother? Why is there no one with me? So I was pouring out my feelings at being motherless. As I was bending down, I thought, well, I must stand up. So I stood up. And I thought that was the end of it. I thought the next one would be much easier. Because you had to make three matanyas. Three were necessary to complete the rite. I made the second matanya, and this time I repeated the same words that I had said before. And this time, when I came to complain of being motherless, when I said, my mother has died and I feel sad and alone, I was bending my head down on the ground, and I heard a voice behind my head. From somewhere behind my head, I heard a voice say, I will be your mother. And I didn't know who was speaking. I heard the voice clearly. It was a beautiful voice. It was soft, but it was clear. It was sweet, but it was strong. It was a very affecting female voice. And she said, I will be your mother. In English, I said, I will be your mother. And I didn't know who was speaking. So I thought perhaps one of the Serbian women had heard me crying or heard my voice and came to support me. So I looked to the left and to the right to see if any woman had come to offer her help. But no one was there. I was alone. Then I repeated the words, and again the voice came, I will be your mother. So this time I was determined to find out. I lifted up my eyes, and the icon was in front of me on the wall. And as I lifted up my eyes, St. Mary moved out of the icon and stood in front of it. Not her whole body, but it was an icon of her top, her to the waist, and she was in the icon holding Jesus. She herself alone, she just moved out. She put her head out of the icon. Like, the icon remained on the wall, completely undisturbed, but she appeared as a presence in front of it. And she bent her head toward me, and she looked at me eye to eye. And she smiled, and she said, I will be your mother for the third time. And when she smiled, she was so lovely. And she was so loving. And her words just took all the pain out of my heart, and gave me hope, and gave me faith, and gave me a belief in myself again. All of this happened in an instant of time when she said, I will be your mother. And in that moment, I was made new. I was reborn, if you like. I was made new, made into a new man. By her love, by her eyes, her smile, her voice, her presence. It was something electric, which just filled me with a presence. And then she started to give off light. Her whole body started to shine. And I had to lower my eyes and bend my head down. So I made the third matanya, and I finished. Then, as I looked up, as I stood up for the third time, she passed back into the icon, as if she melted back into it. And the icon, the light disappeared, and she was gone. The icon became still, and it was only a picture. But her presence had been real, and her presence had been life-changing. I saw her, I heard her, and I felt her love. And that moment made me dependent on her for all my life. From that moment when I stood up, I knew that my life was now dedicated only to her. That her love for me was so great and sufficient that it would keep me alive. So all my pain, all my doubts, all my fears, all my lostness, all my emptiness, all my need of love, everything was filled by her. in an instant of time. And I left that church convinced that I was now, I had a mother. I had a loving mother. I had a mother who was not only beautiful and sweet, but she was kind and she was generous and she was so many full things as well. All of this knowledge of her, I got by her love, through her love. It didn't need a long time of living with her to know her. I knew her immediately. And she showed herself fully in that moment of time, in her smile, in the way that she passed her love to me. And every time I've seen her since, it's been the same. I've seen her several times since then. And that's why I couldn't leave that church. I couldn't go away from that monastery. I had to stay with her, and I had to stay near her. And so I stayed in that Serbian monastery. I told the bishop I don't want to leave. And I stayed from that day in the Orthodox monastery. I will tell you shortly about how I changed to the Coptic Church, but from that day I was finished with the world. I never went back. I didn't go back to the university. I didn't continue teaching. I didn't continue to live in my house. I abandoned everything for her. So it was as if my full monasticism fell on me with St. Mary's love. And that's how come I became a Christian. Of course, I stayed in the Christian church, because where else would I find this loving mother who has given me my new life?